So hello again and welcome to the fifth day of this retreat, alive, aware and awake. And I'm going to be talking about the fourth foundation of mindfulness. So we got to the last one. And it is mindfulness of dhammas. So there is another Pali word for you. And it's only little, so I thought I'd put it in anyway. Dhammas is one of those funny little words that actually has quite a few meanings. Sometimes with a capital D, people mean the truth or the teaching of the Buddha, the path that we practice. And sometimes it means just things or phenomena or experience with a little D for Dhamma. But in this context, when I'm talking about mindfulness of Dhammas, I'm talking about mindfulness of the nature of reality or the nature of experience. So what is it really like if we look into it? And yesterday when I finished a talk on citta, I was saying that actually, as well as becoming a happy, healthy human being through the practice of mindfulness, we can go further. And I talked about transforming self and world. And you might be thinking, oh, hang on, well, we've done these three foundations, body, feeling tone or vedana, and the emotions and thoughts of citta, and it all seems to be a bit about me. It's all quite subjective. So I want to talk a little bit about that, because actually the whole world is in there as well. You might just not have noticed it. So I want to say a little bit about how we experience everything, how we experience everything. So for example, today we're in the Tara cabin and it's a hot sunny day and the sun is of course out, we're midsummer and it's daytime. And because of that, there's light and I can see what's around me. I can see shapes and colours. I can see my fellow community members watching me. So there needs to be something that is perceived. And in this case, there's visual things. I can see light and shape. But I also, to do that, need to have something to do to see with, so I have eyes that function. But I need more than that. I also need some sort of consciousness or awareness that recognises or experiences that visual sensation. So I need those three things all together. And what that means about in terms of, well, where is the world in that? It's that everything external, that we think of as external, so the world out there, is mediated through the senses, through my senses, through your senses. We can only perceive the world through the senses that we have. And that means that what we perceive is limited by our senses. So I cannot echolocate like a bat. I cannot see ultraviolet like I think bees can. I don't necessarily feel vibrations through the ground like a snake. So I experience the world in a particular way, in a human way. But that doesn't mean that's how the world is. It's just what I can experience of it. And then how I experience it is with my mind. So that's the other aspect, is consciousness I need to have to experience it. So that also, so what that means is that the whole world always arises for me, always is experienced with mind, in my mind. Yeah? So everything is there in these foundations. So to become aware or mindful of the nature of reality, it requires that we have a mind that can be aware of that reality. And as you might have noticed yesterday when I was talking about citta, these thoughts or emotions, the mind is not neutral. So the mind, the state of the heart mind, the state of our thoughts and emotions colours what we perceive, colours our experience. So if you think of a day, maybe there's a day in your life when you fell in love and you imagine walking out in the world in that state, and imagine what the world looks like when you're in that state, fallen in love. And then maybe there's also been a day in your life where you've lost someone very dear to you. They've just died. And you walk out into the world. And what does the world look like? And I'd suggest that the two worlds you experience are totally different. And that's to do with the colouring of our emotions and thoughts. Yeah. But more than our moods and emotions and thoughts, we also, our mind is also doing a lot of interpretation of perception. It adds meaning and significance and value. So there's quite an interesting little example of this in that Vajragupta gives in his book Free Time. So he just talks about the way, going back to the sight experience. So in terms of the neural aspect of sight, the visual pathway is between, I don't know much about the brain, but anyway, between the thalamus and the cortex of the brain. So that's the visual pathway. So that's active when I'm seeing things, and when you're watching this, this will be active. But actually there's 6 times more activity in other parts of your brain cortex. So your brain isn't just doing seeing, like bare seeing, it's doing a lot more. What it's doing is your eyes are darting about all over the place, but you don't notice that. And you're blinking, but you don't notice you're blinking. And it's interpreting perspective, distance, all sorts of things, and then recognizing. So actually, there's loads of stuff that's going on that the mind does that you don't even know about. It's quite unconscious, quite automatic. This filling in the gaps, filling in the gaps. And that isn't a problem. So none of this is a problem, except, of course, we really, really believe that we don't fill in the gaps. We think that what we experience is totally objective and just how it is. And I think one interesting thing it's worth considering is maybe that's not the case. Maybe that's not the case. So the mind is doing all of this. So to consider the nature of reality, we need to think about both the nature of the mind that is experiencing reality, and also the nature of experience that is being perceived by the mind. So I'm going to cover both of those. So according to Buddhism, the nature of mind can be clear or obscured. Yeah, and the natural state of the mind is said to be clear. But often our mind is not in a natural state, it's more obscured. But when we talk about obscuration, sometimes the word adventitious is used. So adventitious means that things come in from the outside. So whatever's obscuring the mind is in a way coming in from the outside and can also go back out again, yeah, leaving the natural state of mind. So this is a very positive image for the state of mind, the natural state of mind. And the image that's often used, or sometimes used, is that it's clear. So the mind is clear and still like a pool of water. And it is so clear and still that when you drop things into it, a little pebble or a shell, I can see them distinctly, clearly, perfectly. Yeah. So there's nothing getting in the way. So that's the nature of mind. And because there's nothing getting in the way, I can recognize experience for what it is, and then I can respond in an appropriate way, in other words, a creative way. But most of the time, our minds are not like that. They are obscured or disturbed in some sort of way. So there's traditionally different sorts of obscuration. So I've got some glasses of water here. I'm going to do the obscurations. One, I've got some red poster paint. So if I give that a little bit of a stir, then our clear water then becomes coloured. So this is like the colouring I was talking about when we're in love or in a state of grief. So often, the water being dyed a particular colour is often associated, traditionally, the image is for the mind that is full of craving or grasping, a sense desire, yeah? And everything that we see is clouded by that, is coloured by that. And then we have, and this was a tricky one for me, then we have a mind that the water is boiling. So I thought, oh goodness, how am I going to do boiling water in here? I've come up with an alternative. It's actually a bit shabby alternative. I thought, well, what if I make some bubbles? We'll see how this works. It's not boiling, I know. But more like I've kind of got bubbles which obscure, in the same way as when boiling water is sort of rolling and bubbling and steaming. You can't see through to the bottom of it. So that's an image for hatred or ill will. Yeah, the mind is just full of steam and heat. Yeah, and it disturbs the mind in that sort of way. So then we've got another sort of mind, which has got a load of pondweed in it. Gloop. You can see the problem with that. So this is the mind that is lethargic or drowsy. Yeah, it's falling asleep. It's sluggish. Yeah, bit like pondweed in the mind. And then we've got the mind, which is very, again, this is a slightly tricky one to do, but it's very agitated and anxious and distracted. And you have the image of the wind. Well, I can't do that very well. Just imagine that one. So the wind blowing across the surface of water, yeah? So actually, it's all right down below, but you just can't see through this agitated surface again. Some of these work better than others. And then you've got the mind that is silty. Kind of full of silt and it's cloudy. So this is a traditional one for doubt. Yeah, a sort of mud or ooze or silt of doubt. So there's the mind, the clear mind, and there's the obscured mind. But with all of those, actually, those obscurations can all settle out and you end up with clear water again. So I was just thinking about, for myself, well, how you work with some of those states of mind. So you might recognise that the sense desire, the craving, the ill will, and the sort of doubt, which is more... relates to the craving, ill will, and ignorance that we were talking about yesterday. And then you've got these other hindrances which are more sort of energetic, the sluggishness and the anxiety and distraction. So it kind of gives you an idea of where the mind can go. But I was thinking yesterday about how can you work with some of those things? So yesterday in my talk, I described how I got into a panic. And underneath that was, I think, unconfidence, which I'll call doubt. So if I just think about, well, how did I work with panic? In a way, I just knew it would pass, so I gave myself time. So there's an image of working with the hindrances where you just have a sense of, in a way, it is a bit like the clear water still. You have a sense of the mind like the sky, and what's passing through is clouds, and you just know that it's going to pass through. So in some ways, it's just a matter of waiting and letting it drift on by. So with the panic, I just knew that if I waited quietly, calmly, it would go. So I didn't need to do anything. But actually that was itself a response. That was a working with the mind. And then what I was left with was a sort of unconfidence, which didn't particularly shift, but which I was very interested in. And my interest is based on a sort of trust or a faith that what comes up into experience can be transformed, even if right now I can't transform it. I trust that actually it's good to allow for things to be seen. They then become available to be worked with. So trust or faith or confidence is another response. With sleepiness, I had a lovely meditation once where, if you've done much meditation, or you've been on a retreat, you will know the experience is excruciating and falling asleep and you just start nodding off. It's really horrible. And one time I was doing that and I just, I thought to myself, actually, it's fine to fall asleep. Falling asleep is not a problem. You can fall asleep, just try and do it with a bit of awareness. that's fine. So then I tried to become aware of what it was like to fall asleep, and it was all sorts of interesting droppings and shiftings and movings of energy. And I got so into it, I was wide awake. So what I did, in a way, what I was doing was meeting that with interest, which is in a way meeting it with the opposite quality, but not in a battle, but more like surrounding what the obscuration is with the opposite. So you could also take something like ill will and surround it with love and see what happens. And then with something like distraction or a sort of mind where I'm craving something, often I just need to remind myself of the consequences, which is what I mentioned yesterday about actually I'm creating myself. Is this the direction I want to go in? And then there is another way of working with hindrances, which with these obscurations, which isn't necessarily recommended, which is sometimes known as suppression. I'll just give an example of it. I think it only works in particular circumstances. So I was on a long meditation retreat. It was in a field. I was very happy. I was getting on with my practice, but I didn't want to go to some of the evening rituals. So I'd go to a different shrine tent. There were several. And when I was walking into the shrine tent, I'd noticed a few people, they're usually the same people, would be there. And in my mind, I went, losers. I mean, obviously not out loud, but in silence. I just went, losers. And a number of days this happened, I was walking in, and this little voice was going, losers. I obviously didn't clock that I was obviously a loser too, going into the same shrine tent. And I realised what I was doing, and then I thought, so are you in positive mental states? I thought, yeah. Are you kind of happy and enjoying the retreat? I thought, yeah. Are you wanting to love beings? I thought, yeah, and it feels like it's there. So what is going on? And all I could think of, it was like some weird little habit, but it was dry as a stick. There actually wasn't any life in it. And I could just simply go, stop it. Stop it. And I could stop. But actually, if anything's got any life in it, stopping it won't work. You'll get into a fight. So I'll just have a little pause. So that's a bit about the nature of the mind. But then the question is, if the mind's clear, then what is it that we perceive? What do we perceive in experience, in all experience? What can we say are the deepest and most fundamental qualities of experience? So again, traditionally, there's maybe three qualities I'll go through. So impermanence is one, that all experience is impermanent. Yeah, it's unstoppable, dynamic, changing, flowing, fleeting. This whole transiency to experience, to life. And if you pay attention to your body, to the feeling tone, to your thoughts, to your emotions, you will notice that they keep changing. So you don't need to look somewhere special, elsewhere. Actually, your experience is impermanent. It is change. So what you need to do is recognize that that is what it is. Yeah. So it's not anything extraordinary and out there. So we can start to recognize and to notice impermanence, and even things that seem very huge and fixed. I was thinking like, well, what about a mountain? And we know mountains change, but you often don't see it. You know, the wind and the water act on it, and you get rock falls and avalanches and erosion. But even when you look at a mountain, the light is constantly changing, the weather constantly changes, the birds fly over, there's little animals, there's plants growing, rocks crack. There's all sorts happening. Now, what of that is and what of that isn't mountain? Does a mountain exist separate from the weather, separate from the plants, separate from the light? When you close your eyes, it's not there, and then it's there again. So actually, all of experience is just changing. It changes constantly. So we can notice that. What it means is that nothing lasts. It means that everything will end. And of course, the big one is death. So everything dies. Everything living dies. But also what it means is that new things constantly arise. change is possible. It happens all the time. You are change. It's not that you need to change, but you are changing. So the question is how? Yeah. So this is what we look for in our experience, and this is what we can particularly notice with a clear mind. Yeah. So then another quality that we might see if we look with a clear mind at our experience is the insubstantial nature of it. So it means that nothing is essentially separate and independent and fixed apart from everything else. Yeah, nothing has an essence or a core that is definable and separable that you can. So every line and boundary we draw around things is provisional and practical, but is not ultimately true. So this is a hammer. So I can say this is a hammer and it's a thing, but actually if it breaks, you know, the head comes off the handle, is it a hammer? And if it's broken in two, which bit of it is the hammer, if it, you know? And if I use it to prop open a window, is it a hammer? If it's a paperweight on my desk, is it still a hammer? Yeah? So in a way, what it is dependent on conditions. It's kind of relative, yeah? Where is the essence of hammer in all of that? So what, and this is true of anything, what anything or anyone is not to be found in an analysis of your bits. What we are is relational. We're relational, dependent upon conditions. We're conditions arising and interacting with other conditions. You might just think about how with any person that you meet, any friend, you'll have a particular relationship or connection. A bit of you sort of flowers with a friend that doesn't necessarily with other friends. So each time you meet a different person, in a way you're a bit of a different person. So who are you in all of that? Who are you? So this is something that we can notice if we look into our experience. And then the third quality I want to mention is often called unsatisfactoriness. I always find that term unsatisfactory, so but maybe that's how it's supposed to be. So I think we can just say that if everything, including us, is ungraspable change, then at a very fundamental level, we can't be satisfied by anything. We can't keep hold of the lovely. We can't push away the unlovely. There is no end point or full stop where everything will be and stay perfect. Yeah, there's always change. There's going to be death. There'll always be something in a way that is imperfect, a bit painful, maybe a bit heartbreaking in experience, and that's how it is. But what that also means is that when we cease to grasp the ungraspable, and when we stop trying to stop the unstoppable and stop refusing that sort of painful poignancy or heartbreak of life, there's a tremendous relief and the letting go and a sense of freedom. So if we can dwell with that, we can dwell in a state where there's change, there's interconnection, and there's poignancy. And all of that starts to blossom. Go and have a coffee. You okay, yeah. And all of that starts to blossom into experience of beauty and the preciousness of life. And none of what I've said means that we don't exist. None of it means that we don't have a choice or agency in the world. We do. But we do so not because we're fixed and separate individuals, but rather because we are deeply interconnected beings in a participative world. And that is the ground in which we make a difference. So just to conclude, we've looked at mindfulness and how that can allow the mind to calm, and how, when it comes, it allows us to see experience more clearly, with clear perception. And then as we see clearly, we can notice the qualities of all perceptions, that they're impermanent, insubstantial, unsatisfactory. And that can profoundly change the quality of our life when we see those things. And that can profoundly change how we live in the world.